building a volumetric model of radioactive pollution of Chernobyl nuclear disaster zone with Russian Academy of Science. And since then, he's earned his reputation as a strategic expert and advisor in all aspects of data management. Prior to joining Denodo, Alexey built and managed an enterprise-wide data integration platforms for industry giants like Nokia and Deutsche Bank. Please welcome on stage again and give a big round of applause. Alexey, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much.
Hi, everybody. So today I would like to dedicate my session to maybe something new that you never heard. And as you can see, the topic of the presentation is data anti-gravity. You might think it's a little bit kind of academical talk. However, I can assure you that you have a lot of practical experience as well. And this is something that I want to share, I want to discuss with you. And I would love to start my presentation with the quotation from Charles Darwin that said that it's not the strongest, not the smartest that survives, but the one that adapts to the changes quickly. We can agree with evolution theory of Mr. Darwin or not. However, I think in the business context, this law works just perfectly. Myself, I worked for the beginning of the century. I joined Nokia Corporation in Finland. It was a very big company, very smart people. However, the problem with Nokia was that they were not able to adapt to the technological changes, to the changes in the customer behavior. They're gone. Why I decided to start my presentation for this quote, because I think, in my opinion, we live in the time when we can witness the biggest change in the data management ever happening since the invention of data warehouse. To explain the term of data anti-gravity, I would love to start with the opposite term that probably for most of you are quite familiar is data gravity. Data gravity is concept that, okay, the big data set attracts the smaller one, getting bigger and bigger, and that's what we want to achieve. We want to move all our data in a single place, and then we'll be able to manage that. Some 25 years ago, the talk was, okay, let's move all your data into a data warehouse. Then you can manage them properly. You can assure data quality. You can do some data governance on top of that. Then we switched to a data lake concept. And the conversation was, again, absolutely the same. Let's move all the data to a single physical data lake, and then we can solve all the data management problems. However, both these concepts, they stayed in the framework, the paradigm of data gravity. What we can see now, you can hear that, okay, now you want to move all your data to a single cloud, and then you'll be happy. Needless to say, by the way, that none of those happened ever. The companies ended up having several data warehouses and several data lakes sitting side by side. What we can see right now, that there are three major anti-gravity forces that are preventing data to be placed in a single physical location. And I will go through them quickly just to explain the concept what I'm gonna tell you next. The first of them is natural geography. The data is everywhere. You can have data in different data centers of your company. You can have some data on-prem, some moved to the cloud. And we can see a rise in the hybrid architectures right now. Even more than that, we are talking about multi-cloud hybrid architectures when some portion of data sits with Amazon, another one with Azure, some data is still on-prem. The question is, how do you manage the data that are geographically distributed? You don't want to move them to a single physical repository anymore, right? Since the data volumes are prohibitive. The second very important anti-gravity force is the technology. Again, when I started to build my first data warehouse in the year 2001, we basically had data in more or less two formats. In a flat file, comma separated, and in the relational data store, as it was Oracle, Microsoft, Teradata. Now we have the whole range of technologies built to manage the data in different ways. And it's not only relational and Hadoop. We can see the whole really range of the NoSQL technologies that are built specifically to address pretty narrow use cases like graph databases, like key value pair databases, time series databases, document stores. We are living in the world of really polyglot persistence. There is a theorem describing this kind of a phenomenon. Data should stay inside the technology that is built for them. If you want to manage, say you are running a web shop, right? For the product catalog, it's a good idea to store the data in the relational database. If you want to analyze the customer network, the household analysis, you better put that data into the graph database. If you want to keep the purchase orders, you can use the document store for that. So the technologies that we use to manage the data, so diversified right now that, again, it does not make any sense to put all the data in a single place. The last but not the least is the ownership problem. It can be the resistance inside the organization when some of the departments don't want to share the data. It can be the problem that arises when we speak, for example, for the ministries of statistics in different countries, that they want to collect all the data from the other government entities, but nobody wants to share the data, nobody wants to delegate the ownership. It can be the countries that are trying to enforce the ownership laws. Imagine you don't have to be a huge multinational enterprise for that. Imagine if you are managing the IT organization of a small, low-cost airline. And that airline flies from Dubai to Beijing and from Dubai to Moscow, for example. You need to keep the customer data somewhere. However, the law in China dictates that the personal data of Chinese citizen must stay inside the Chinese border. Same law is in Russia. Where do you store your data? Data ownership is becoming another anti-gravity force. And guys, all together, these three forces, they are moving us to the completely different paradigm of data management. We live in the world where data are distributed among geographies, among the technologies, owned by different people. And we want to learn how to manage this data without trying to collect them physically into yet another single repository. I have a good news for you, there is a solution. The concept of logical data fabric is pretty new, and I wanna explain it a little bit, and maybe the best way to explain it is just to show how it works. We have all our data in completely different repositories that can be relational databases, that can be analytical data stores like based on Hadoop technologies, that can be graph databases, other NoSQL stuff, cloud or on-prem, and you have your modern data initiatives that not are limited actually to BI reporting anymore whatsoever. Those are predictive prescriptive analytics, machine learning, artificial intelligence, data democratization, open data initiatives. All those projects, they need data first of all. The concept of logical data fabric works like that. Whenever data is needed by the data consumer, the request is coming to this kind of a neural network, and the data is being gathered in the real time and put in the form that is good for consumption. We can build really the model on demand in this case. Not just model on read, but model on demand. If you want to have your data in normal form, here you go. If you want to have it in a star scheme or snowflake, traditional data warehousing stuff, you can do that. If you need a raw data set for data sciences, just cleanse a little bit. Again, we can do that. What we are getting out of that? We are getting the zero replication. At least we can avoid unnecessary replication and not create 3, 5, 10 copies of the same data. Another very important aspect that we are getting almost real-time reflection of the data from the data sources. When I started again working with data warehousing, the requirement was to have, okay, we have T-1 and business was happy. Now nobody wants to know what happened yesterday. Everyone wants to know what's going to happen tomorrow. So being as real-time as possible, it's very crucial for the companies to survive, to go through the competition. Diving a little bit deeper into logical data fabric architecture, if I just turn that a little bit upside down. Again, we have all the possible places where we have data. Relational data stores, applications, data warehouses, Hadoop analytical repositories, NoSQL data sources, data coming in real time from some social networks, from the IoT devices, from the sensors, data sitting in the Excel spreadsheets that are not integrated to either of those, right? With the logical data platform, you can get the access to all that data, combine them on fly, cleanse them on fly, provide end-to-end security protection mechanism that would define which data can be accessed by which group of people or a person. And then those data can be exposed again in a polyglot universal manner to different kind of consumers that requires the data. So this is the concept of logical data fabric. That's basically what Denodo does. If it doesn't do anything else, we are developing this platform and we are providing our customers with the ability to build this kind of architecture. And by the way, it was kind of invented by Denodo. However, there's a common consensus among the data professionals. This is a Gartner report on data management. What happened in the past 40 years. We started with the fragmented architecture when the applications was not connected to each other. We were able to solve that, introducing the concept of data warehouse as abstraction layer for the analytical reporting purposes. However, in the post-data warehouse time, the data landscape became again so diversified. Have several data warehouses, several data lakes, and some other data coming that are not fitting into either of those. And the solution for that is really to build a logical approach. We cannot move the data physically to yet another repository anymore. If you ask me to phrase it in a kind of in a single sentence, the idea of that. We should stop collecting the data and start connecting the data. Similar concept that, for example, Netflix changed the way we watch movies. 20 years ago, everybody had a shelf in the room with the DVDs or video cassettes. And if you wanted to watch the movie, you wanted either buy it or copy from somebody. That's what we have now is data warehouses and the data lakes. If you watch the movie now, you go to Netflix or the similar kind of a service, you click the button, you don't even know where the movie is physically stored. You don't know, you don't want to know what kind of technology is used for that. You don't own that movie, you're owning the right to watch it. Similar idea is we are applying to the data. And another very good quotation to finish my presentation is that it's not longer the big fish that eats the small one. It's the fastest that eats the slow one. So if you want to be fast in your innovation, if you want to be the one who survives, you really need to understand this fundamental change in the data management and go to the virtual concept rather than physical data collection. I hope you have some questions, and we are at the booth over there. The whole Denodo team is ready to help you and explain and show how it works. So for Q&A, please come to our booth, and thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Alexey. Give a big round of applause. It was a really informative and a powerful presentation. And like he said, if you have any questions and would like to discuss it more in detail with him and any of our other speakers, please join them.